So we published a video on creatine last week, and a lot of you guys asked about creatine and hair loss. Does creatine supplementation cause hair to fall out? And I had never heard this question before. I had never heard this point raised, so I looked into it. And I know there's lots of personal stories. Lots of you guys shared in the comments, some saying you saw hair loss, some saying you didn't. I understand. I believe all those stories. The issue with anecdotes is there's always a number of things going on. So what we're trying to address in this video is, scientifically, do we have any compelling evidence that creatine causes hair loss, yes or no? So it seems that the whole idea stems from a study that was published in 2009. And this was a randomized trial where they took 20 young college-age rugby players, all men, and they split them randomly and they gave them either creatine supplements or a placebo. And the regime was 25 grams a day for the first week, so that's called a loading phase, and then another 2 weeks of 5 grams a day. So that's called the maintenance phase. And they measured a number of hormones in the blood of these participants, and total testosterone was not changed with the creatine supplements. But this other metabolite called dihydrotestosterone, which is a byproduct of testosterone, testosterone can get converted into this dihydrotestosterone, or DHT for short, and that was elevated by 56% after the first week of creatine loading, the high dose, and after the 3 weeks, the whole loading plus maintenance phase, it was still elevated by 40%. And so the whole link to hair loss has to do with these hormones, because testosterone itself doesn't cause baldness, but this DHT, dihydrotestosterone, has been linked to male pattern baldness. This pattern where males start losing hair with age, and obviously there's a susceptibility there. Some people, some families have it, some families don't. And the way this happens mechanistically is testosterone can get converted into DHT by a specific enzyme, and some people convert more than others. And then this DHT can bind to the hair follicles. Specifically, there's a receptor called the androgen receptor in the hair follicles, and that binding can cause the follicles to shrink. This is known as miniaturization. And so this can cause hair to become thinner and weaker, and the growth cycle of the hair can be shortened. And so this can lead to hair loss. Of course, this depends on individual susceptibility. Some people have this predisposition and some don't. So that's the origin of this question. In this trial, they reported an increase in DHT. There's this link between DHT and hair loss, baldness. So the question is, does it cause it? One thing to point out is in this trial, they never reported any hair measurements. They didn't look at whether they were losing hair or not. They just looked at the hormone levels. The other thing to point out is that even after that increase that they report, all the hormones were still well within the normal range. So if we look at the levels here, the starting level of DHT was around 1, 0.98 specifically in the creatine group, and then it goes up to 1.5 and then down to 1.4. But the normal range of DHT goes all the way up to 2 or 3, depending on the lab. So all of these values are well within the normal range. Another thing to point out is that this observation has never been repeated. As far as I know, no other trial has shown this elevation of DHT with a creatine supplement. So I think that trial from 2009 is not a strong argument that creatine causes hair loss, but it's a valid hypothesis. It's a valid question. So in 2021, a group of authors published a paper going over a lot of frequently asked questions on creatine, and one thing they touched on was exactly this question of creatine and hair loss. And they basically conclude that there's no convincing evidence for that link, and they talk about this 2009 rugby trial that we touched on. They go over a couple of the points that we already covered, and they cover one more thing that's a little nerdier, but bear with me, we're going to go over it really quick. It's not that bad. Basically, when you look at the numbers, they look to be a little higher on the placebo group before the trial, so 1.26 compared to 0.98 in the creatine supplement group. And this difference is not significant, but what they suggest is that maybe it's a little higher, and as time goes on, we see the number come down in the placebo group, and we see the number go up in the creatine group, but that maybe this is a result of them being a little bit different before the trial. So this is called return to the mean. It happens in statistics. Sometimes if you measure two groups, and just by chance, one is a little high and one is a little low, the next time you measure the parameter, the tendency is going to be for them to converge towards the average. So sometimes this is seen, and they suggest that this might be going on here, that maybe by chance the placebo group was a little higher, the values, and the creatine group was a little lower before the intervention, and then with time they kind of drifted towards the average, and that that's helping this effect be observed. It's a possibility. Realistically, this is all settled in science when you repeat things. You look at other trials that ask the same question, and do they seem the same thing or not? In this case, because it's never been reproduced, there's all these questions in the air. Bottom line, this paper concludes that current evidence does not indicate that creatine raises the total or free testosterone levels or DHT or causes hair loss or baldness. So that's kind of their conclusion. Now, at the time, 2021, this question had never been tested directly. So they're saying, we don't have strong evidence for this link, but we don't have strong evidence against it either. And that all changed this year, the year of our Lord, 2025. Just a couple of months ago, in April, the first trial, and to my knowledge, the only trial so far to look directly at this question, giving people creatine supplements and actually looking at hair and measuring hair parameters and asking, is there hair loss? So this was a randomized controlled trial, 38 men, male pattern baldness obviously tends to affect men. Women have other issues, but this is one thing on our backs. And they basically split the participants randomly into two groups and gave a creatine supplement to one group and a placebo to the other. And the regime was 5 grams of creatine a day for 3 months. So that was the duration of the trial. And at the end of the 3 months, there was no significant difference in free testosterone levels, total testosterone levels, DHT levels, or hair parameters. So they looked at hair count, hair density, hair thickness, a number of hair parameters, and there was no significant change. So the only trial so far to look directly at this question did not find evidence to support this link. The strength is that this was 3 months. It's 4 times longer than the original Rugby trial. One caveat here, and this is a little annoying, is they gave these participants 5 grams of creatine a day throughout, right, for the whole 3 months. And if you remember, in the Rugby trial, there was a 1 week loading phase where they got a lot more. They got 25 grams of creatine for that week. And then the rest of the trial, they got 5 grams a day. So this is a little annoying because this trial is designed largely to test this idea coming from the Rugby trial, largely as a response to that Rugby trial. It would have been nice if they did it the exact same way, right? The first week, 25, and then 5 grams a day for the rest of the trial. They didn't do that, which leaves this question open. Maybe if you go to a higher dose, maybe that causes problems. So the conclusion is the only test we have so far, and it's a randomized trial looking at this question, doesn't show an effect of creatine supplementation on hair loss, at least with 5 grams a day for 3 months. What happens with a higher dose or with a longer exposure? This trial can't address that. That's an open question. And that's always how it is. We can always ask, what about higher? What about longer? To be determined. What about the effect of creatine supplements on muscle mass, fat mass, strength, and is it safe for the kidneys? We covered all of that last week, so check out that video if you haven't yet, and I'll see you in there.